I was simply having breakfast and reading the newspaper, and it was an interesting article about how some professors at Santa Ana College had gotten together and agreed to each put in $500 of their own money to start a scholarship fund for kids who literally could not afford to return for the second year because they could not afford the textbooks. When I entered this, I thought I had a problem. And what I realized is I had one leg of an elephant. And it really wouldn't matter where you grabbed on. The thing is enormous. There are about 60 million people going to school in the United States today. The textbook publishing industry is in excess of a $20 billion a year industry. It's hard to be able to explain why some commoditized knowledge, such as a geometry which hasn't changed in 2,000 years, or a calculus which hasn't changed since Isaac Newton, how could those textbooks cost between $150 and $200 a piece? The whole system just seemed broken. The goal is to provide super high quality textbooks to students at either no cost or nominal cost. Dean Flores was the California Senate Majority Leader. You either get to be the Senate Majority Leader because you are the best player on that TV show Survivor, or a lot of people really like you. He's the latter. Everybody likes Dean. I met him when he was in the Senate. He made such an impression on me that at one point I came back to him and I told him what I was thinking about and dealing with about the textbooks.
In the legislature, always involved in higher education and really, really immersed at that time, even before pads, even before iPhones, that the world was quickly going to turn to something different other than a bound textbook. With term limits in California, there's only so many terms you can run. I termed out in the Assembly, termed out in the Senate. And I was really fortunate to meet a great visionary, Gary Michelson, as a person who is one patent away from Ben Franklin, who has been inducted to the Inventor Hall of Fame. I mean, he's an innovator. Whether it's been in medical equipment, whether it's been in procedures and surgery, whether it's been some of his foundations like Found Animals. And so it wasn't a surprise to me when he created 20 Million Minds that he was very, very focused on looking at ed tech technology and asking the question, do we always have to keep doing the things the way they've always been done?
Well, I was born in Philadelphia. That was a great time to be a little kid because you could walk down the street and people would have stuff in their trash cans like a phonograph. You take it home, you take it apart, you fix it, and now you were a 5 or 6 year old kid with a phonograph. After I graduated school, sadly, I actually had to start teaching myself the subjects that I would have known if I'd only paid attention when I was in school. I worked my way through college. I actually put myself through medical school, which they say you can't do. I drove cabs at night. I washed cars at a car dealership. I cleaned animal cages in research laboratories. I went into an area of endeavor where the results were really poor. Nobody wanted to be a spine surgeon because half the patients didn't get better, they got worse. Every time I would say to a patient, we need to take out a disc, they were smarter than I was. They would say, great, what are you putting back? The answer was nothing. And that's not a good answer. So that started me thinking, and nowadays, the things we put back either are the very things I invented, or they're based on what I invented, or they make use of the instruments I invented, or they are the surgical procedures I invented. I actually invented an improved child's seat, a booster seat, a high retention microchip. When you chip an animal, the chip doesn't have to stay where you put it, and then that defeats the purpose because they scan the animal and they can't find the chip. All the money came from selling those patents, yes, that patent portfolio.
Gary has given an endowment to this foundation of $25 million. He recognizes that we, as innovators here at this 20 Million Minds Foundation, have one clear mission, and that is to think 4 or 5 years ahead of the curve. I think the very premise of all our books is that they are open, and open means, from our perspective, that a faculty member or a student could repurpose the information, they could reuse it, they could redirect it, and more importantly, they can, in essence, make it their own.
Wouldn't it be great if the teacher could simply select for the level of difficulty he was looking for that was appropriate for the students he was teaching? Give him a platform that he can change this stuff any way he wants.
You can change this thing the day after the election in political science. You're not waiting 5 years for the next adoption cycle to realize that George Bush isn't the president anymore and you're in the second term of Barack Obama.
You can then have interactive learning. What if you could hit a hyperlink and there's Watson and Crick with their original three-dimensional models explaining to you how DNA and RNA work?
The faculty members need to make a critical decision on whether or not they're going to resist or participate in this online tsunami. Professors have an opportunity to actually do very, very well in this environment if they just follow some of their, you know, your brethren from the record industry. You really see how the artists became somewhat more free, and they began to take more control of their own destinies. And professors have never done this. They've always allowed publishers to give them the measly 10%. Even though the knowledge that was created in this book was simply almost all, if anything, the artists, the faculty member, the professors. What needs to happen in this digital shakeout is that publishers need to be more honest about what the true price of producing a digital book is, what the true price of updating is. Because in essence, we're all helping them because we're getting rid of the nemesis for publishers, which is the used book.
Our first textbooks literally cost us $1 million a piece. Today we could do it for probably a fourth of that. We formed this group called OpenStax, the Hewlett Foundation, the Gates Foundation, the Maxfield Foundation, and 20 Million Minds essentially bankrolled the production of these first textbooks.
Phil Kim was running this foundation when I came over. Phil has had just about every argument with every publisher. The foundation would not be anywhere close to where we are today without Phil. So Phil, where are we in terms of the production of the open source textbooks at this point in time?
I think the model that's been established up to this point has worked pretty well. The titles that have been released already have already saved students more in terms of kind of a return on that investment, have saved more than we've put into the production costs. So now we're really kind of targeting this magic number of 25 titles, which has the potential to impact roughly half of the student population.
There's a lot of things that have to be disrupted simultaneously, which then evolves into another leg on this elephant.
In California, we have a backlog of over 500,000 students waiting for English 1 or Algebra 1. 500,000 students waiting for the one course necessary for them to move through their education. The system, clearly at this point, for most students, is completely broken. And the institutions themselves don't really see that online is going to solve that. Gary really felt that the real culprit in higher education was this old notion of seat time. The only way universities got paid and the only way that people could learn was to assign a seat to a student who would sit there for 15 weeks in a semester. This is all fine until the internet hit. And now people wondered, you know, do you have to be in your seat anymore?
So you have this sort of massive open online course technology. What's missing is the payoff. So that's why you have 385,000 people sign up and 30,000 people finish. It's not because the other people are lazy or stupid. It's because there is no payoff.
What do they have to offer if there's no real accreditation behind them yet?
I think we're starting to see sort of this whole alternative pathway. And you're talking about kind of what happened in the music industry when, right, Dean, iTunes came along and you see the album kind of fall apart. You see the disaggregation of these kind of once held infallible, holy concepts. But now you're starting to see even the degree can be broken down into different pieces. And a group like Accredible actually gives a little bit more substance to a statement from somebody saying, hey, I took this great course at Code Academy, or I took this great course through peer-to-peer university, or Udacity, or Coursera, to actually take that and put some weight behind it.
Senator Steinberg put in a bill earlier this year saying that if a student couldn't find any of these bottleneck courses at any of the California institutions, they could take an online equivalent offered by a, quote, certified provider, whether it be Udacity or Coursera or Straighter Line, and they would receive credit. That was an extremely bold move, and of course it's been resisted heavily. I think it kind of shows everybody's colors in this thing. It kind of shows the fact that really nobody's really interested in change. They kind of like the status quo. And students, however, I think are kind of looking for a different path.
I keep telling you that this thing's like an elephant. So we're on two legs now. Just let me start telling you about the trunk. We shouldn't have textbooks in grammar school. We should give them this bulletproof, shatterproof, waterproof reader that comes from India and it's less than $65. And you can load 250 textbooks in there or anything you want. Part of what you can do with these readers is you can actually make them two ways. We see what they highlight and what they didn't highlight on these readers. And then we say to ourselves, look, here's a paragraph nobody highlighted anything. This has got to be garbage. Let's get rid of that. That's not effective learning. And here's something everybody highlighted. Why don't we put that in bold? Again, it's all disruptive. Everything we're doing is disruptive.
I kind of look 20 years out and see students creating their own majors, 20 different universities, 20 different courses, picking every course that they need and packaging it to an employer who says that's exactly what we're looking for.
What we're doing in creating these textbooks will change the world. It won't change California United States. It's going to change. There'll be some guy in Zimbabwe sitting in a hut with an internet connection learning physics in his language.